Thomas Patrick Ward, tune in the Sport and Icons.
Hello?
Hello, Andy.
Yes, it is. Speaking.
Hello, buddy. Phil Jeffries here. Give me your number to give you a call. This is for Sport and Icons.
Oh, yes, you mentioned it. Yeah.
How are you?
Honestly, I'm just sitting in my art studio.
Uh-huh.
At the side of my house, and I'm painting there with the colour, Florence Nightingale.
Uh-huh.
And honestly, I tell you, it gets very emotional. I painted been busy painting a lady called Mary Seacole as well.
Okay.
She was in the Crimean War. A friend of mine, and have you heard of Alan Lord?
Right.
He'd done 39 years in Strangeways, the prison. Right. He was the first one of the lads on top of the roof, a dark lad, and he's tossed all the tiles off the roof at Strangeways.
Right, yeah.
And he's done 29 years. It's the people I mixed with there, they were the art, it took us in different directions, you know?
Yeah.
So,
well, you know that.
Yep.
I see, I've seen you probably about three or four times, haven't I, at the boxing shows. I took a picture of Barry Hearn that you'd done as well. And
he still hasn't paid for that one, you know.
Has he not?
No.
Ah, cheeky git. I'll give him a call in a bit.
Aye, aye.
Now, when he's spoken to me, do I remember right that you've spent time with Charlie Bronson?
I've been to visit him three times. The last visit I had with him, we had a big spot at the end of the session.
Did you?
I said to him, I swallowed you, Charlie, left-handed or right-handed. He jumped up, he says, "Parkin for you." He says, "I'm any-handed, come on." And there was two screws then, we just got mucked into each other a bit.
Right.
And he stood, he says, "Oh, then give us a body shot, give us your best shot." So I sent one into his ribcage.
Yeah.
And he flinched. And I said, "Right, Charlie, he's three big ones coming in now." And I just pulled them back, you know, I never heard them. And he smiled at us, you know. I've had some riveting conversations with Charlie. It's unbelievable how passionate he is about art. You know?
Yeah.
It's amazing. As I said, just he dropped down as well. He invented, we call them the crocodile press-ups.
Okay.
The screw who was in with her watching us, there was a young lady in another screw, and he says, "Charlie, show me press-ups." So he says, "I'll show you." He says, I invented these in 1978 when he was in Parkhurst.
Uh-huh.
I think he was in with the Career Twins, he was. And he just dropped down, and when you do a normal press-up, now when you jump up and clap your hands.
Uh-huh.
Well, as he jumped up and clapped his hands, he moved forward about 6 inches. And he jumped up again, clapped his hands in a special position, and moved forward. Five times he moved forward, five times back, then five times forward. And he jumped up, not a breath. He said, "There you go, I'm 67-year-old. What do you think, Andy?" And just amazing, you know.
He's a strong lad, isn't he?
Honestly, he's got a strong resolve for what he's been through. I mean, the last visit we had, I got an email from him. And he says, "Andy, put your best topper on, son."
Mm-hmm.
He said, "Pay for pictures for us to get our pictures took." He's put, "You can't put on social media." As Charlie asked, "I wouldn't say you got out of prison."
Right.
And when we got there, the governor changed her mind.
Uh-huh.
And she wouldn't let us get our pictures took.
Oh.
And to me, that's all it is, where they just wanted Charlie to get a reaction. But really, tell you the truth, the old Charlie's changed now and he didn't react.
Does he want to come out now, does he?
Oh, he wants to get out. He can't wait to get out.
Oh, that's good.
He's got the sequel for the film, you know.
That's a good film, with Tom Hardy, yeah?
Aye, he told us this. Do you want to hear the story about Tom Hardy?
Uh-huh, go on.
Aye, Tom Hardy coming to visit him. He says, "Look, I want somebody to star as me in the film."
Mm-hmm.
He says, "Tom Hardy, come on." He says, "I looked at him. He says, mate, you're too skinny." He says, "Get yourself away, get in the train and come back and see us." He says, 2 months later, he come back twice the size. He said, "What the hell are you putting in this lad?" Because Charlie's so anti-drugs.
Yeah.
He hates drugs, and he tries to help young kids who's in prison. He says, "Come here, touch them under his wing." But once he hears that they're on the spice or whatever that's in there, he just says, look, John, I can help you name there, you know. But Tom Hardy did come back after he slimmed down, and Charlie was happy with him. I think he enjoyed the feed. I don't actually know if he's saying it for him, but he's telling me about the sequel, which way it's going to be and everything. And, you know, it's happy days, and it's a pleasure. And he's inspired me over the years with the artwork to the standard I'm getting to today. I give him a big tribute to that, you know, because...
Well, maybe you've inspired him as well to like... maybe in some ways you've inspired him as well to like...
Oh, I'm honest with the two, but... And the thing that he says... Those three was in the end of the visit, and he went, Andy, tell these about the best piece of art you've done. And I said, well, I haven't done it yet, have I, Charlie? He says, no. He says, we haven't created the best piece yet. It's yet to come. But tell you the truth, these pins I'm doing at the minute, I'm getting very emotional with them. I think I've got the art radio on. Listen to that. I'm in the art studio here. And I just listening to it sounds like I'm looking at a picture on my phone, that's all I'm looking at. And I'm painting it, that just thing comes to life, you know? It's scary.
Well, you're an amazing artist. I've seen like quite a few of us, like, you bring them in.
It's in life. Life sends you some challenges. I was an Xbox, I had 70 fights. I fought for the 78, I fought Dudley McKenzie.
Right.
The McKenzie bully, Dudley Clinton and Duke McKenzie, who was on the telly. I fought him at the Bloomsbury Crest Hotel. But in my semi-final fight, I fought a lad called Alan Lodge. And he shouted at us after I beat him. He was a little stocky fella, not a puncher.
Right.
He was in Wisbech. And he shouted, Parkin, you never beat McKenzie. Because in them days, you had 2 weeks grace before you fought for the final. Me, I never give it a thought. All I shouted back was, I beat you, Lodge, so get yourself on your way. And I was mad bothered about coming back to Sunderland, and my brother, who Tom was driving us, and he zoomed up the motorway from Wisbech, and I got to the nightclub, the Mayfair in Sunderland, the Mecca, for 11 o'clock. Don Box, though.
Oh, you're still there?
Turns out he was a
cycle. Hang on a second, Andy, you're breaking up a bit. I can hardly hear you. But 1 second, I'll get you called back. I'll call you back.
Okay, no problem. Hello, mate.
Hello, buddy. I can hear you now.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Are you recording this now, like?
Yeah, I am, yeah.
Oh, Christy. I get down to London with me and Robbie Buick from Sunderland ABC. There's Kevin Foggan from Lampton Street and Stevie Miller from Hilton Castle Boxing Club. All of us in the finals for the Junior Bears, 1978. So, went in. First thing happened, he comes out, he's a southpaw, isn't he? Nobody told us he's a southpaw, yet in that year, in 1973, if I'm correct, he went in the box and broke the records. At 17, he won every title he fought for.
Oh.
You know? Aye, and have a look at him, and God bless him, he died a few years later.
Oh, bless him.
Aye, I reckon he's one of the best out of the three brothers, don't you know? It's a crazy game, but after that, I had a few more fights and I started getting dizzy spells, blackouts and everything. I chucked it and but do you know about one of my memorable fights?
Go on, yeah.
I fought a lad called Bobby Wellburn from Old Fish Trains. I fought him at the Rex Hotel. And I seen one afternoon, it was the National Boys Cup Championships, I think about 1977 or something, or 78 or something. And I seen him knock somebody out, and he just come in with an old pair of trainers on, and a daft old t-shirt. And I looked, I said, oh, I'll box them. Anyway, I didn't fight them till 10 to 12 on the Saturday night, so I'm waiting about, you know, when you get lost in your energy through nervous energy. And then I went in with them, And my trainer, Pasty Brown, said, look, Andy, get him, knock him. And I'm not a puncher, I'm not a fighter, I'm a boxer, right. Type of move. So I went in, and must have knocked us down about 10 times in the fight. And what happened, his trainer come up at the end of the fight, he went, Parkin, he said, will you fight and do fridge trades on Monday? I said, I'm working. He said, what do you get paid a week, wages? Well, I was apprentice bricklayer, I said, I get £17.50. Mm-hmm. He went, look, he said, I'll pay you £17.50. He says, and I'll give you the best trophy of the night. That was a week's wages and the best trophy. Yeah. My dad said no, my trainer, Tommy Musky said no, Pasty Brown said no, but old Matty says, no, we'll fight you. So I said, Sean was at school, he took the day off school. So we travelled down with Frankie Deans and them, the Deans brothers,
right.
From Jarrah, Perth Green. So we travelled down with them and went in the place, in the boozer. Honest, it was absolutely like stacked to the rafters. And got ready. Matty's already on now, so Matty's in my corner. You know, in them days, anybody would go in your corner.
Right.
So I went through the crowd, like, put my arms on his shoulders. It was that packed.
Wow.
I've never experienced nothing like it. And as I'm walking through the crowd, they're all shouting, Parkin, you're going down this time, you're stopping down. And I whispered to Matty, I said, I think I've just come down here for the ride. And Matty said, the oldest brother he is, he says, get on the back foot, son, stick that jab out. He says, beat him. Because he was a little stocky fella. So I got in, shook hands, come at us like he did, expecting it. He was a southpaw as well, mind ya. Come at us, trying to bomb us out the way. And I just jabbed his head off. Jab, jab, jab. And I was looking, I was smiling, and Matty was laughing. And Matty, in the second round, Matty got chased out the corner. So Sean had to come in with us. And that's my younger brother, was Sean. He was British champion as well, was Sean. He won NABCs in the 70s. And obviously, Matty got chased out of the corner, he got a red card. And in the third round, I just went in the middle of the ring. And I said, no way. And I just moved on, we had called him a couple of times. But I didn't realise, if I'd have stopped him, he would have been out of the ring for 28 days.
Oh.
And how to get through the next round of championships, you know. I never realised anybody told us. It's a weird how boxing now is so clinical, to the point where you know you're fighting, you get to see them all, but them days you never seen them, you know.
Yeah.
It's a funny old game.
It is.
But getting back to the McKenzie fight, he dropped us in the first round, and I looked back at Colonel and I said, Tommy, anybody told me? Me, it was like, it was a southpaw, you know,
yeah.
And they were coming there in the middle of the rounds, so, and he just like took us apart. But my dad, on the same night, the Franklin brothers were fighting boxing, the travelling family,
right?
And my dad took more pictures because in them days was no like phones on out, so my dad had a camera with 20 pictures on. He took more pictures of the fighting in the crowd than he did of my fight. I think I took two pictures of my fight. And he ran out of pictures. And, but, the way God, when I got to 40 years old, I had a bit of a band up fight with somebody, and they fractured my skull.
Oh.
And then after that, I started getting dizzy spells. See, I packed in boxing when I was 18.
Right.
And then, we had three kids at 21. And then, I did another fight at the Babinay Club, and the lad knocked us out. I went to the front door, on the door, and I knocked him out, and we got friends, and misunderstanding. And the next year, I started falling down the stairs, vomiting and everything. I had a fractured skull, put in hospital. And they sent for a brain scan. The doctor says, you've got a brain tumour.
Brilliant.
Out of the room, and dear me. And I was just sitting there by myself. He left the room for about 15 minutes. And then the funniest thing was this. Well, I sent you to see a man called Leon Timmisis or something at the Sunderland General Hospital. So I went there. And this doctor, he's getting his, I'm putting you in a sound booth. You might see what's putting, but, you know, see which way it affects you. This, what's it called? Dizzy spells and that. Vertigo. Anyway, I went in the booth, nothing noises, and that happened. So we come out, so we start bending us side to side, and backwards and frontwards. I said, what are you trying to do? He said, I'm trying to make you more dizzy. I said, normally your right hand works. And he just looked at us, he was a duck in the bed, just let the boys in. But anyway, by the by, yeah, we got an appointment to go to Newcastle Hospital, and called, see my dad first, he's on these allotment at Castletown, see my mum, and so man for the death, brain scan, he's still there, so I'll come through, yeah. And he come with his like dungarees on and went to hospital, but walked in, there was a doctor, oh, I can't remember his name now, but walked in, there's about 10 different surgeons there, my bag, my toilet was in, and they've done tests on my head, on his moving us about, and there's a man got a doctor called Dr. Goldcard from America in town that week, and he made the decision, he said, Mr. Parkin, he said, we're looking at you, it's an acroid cyst on the stem of the brain that you've got, it disguises itself as a tumour. It's about it's bigger than a pea or double the size of a pea. Mm-hmm. It's growing slowly, but it covers itself in fluid. Mm-hmm. The brain's a clever thing, and they get sacked around it. So we're not going to operate, so I come up with the operation, and it just affects us all the time, you know. And but I'm pleased that he said, there's lucky you did pack in boxing, because if you hadn't, you could have been brain damaged. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a what they call Terry Offmander. Terry McCann,
right.
His brother was a boxer, and I read his book, and I was getting seeing the signs that he had brain damage.
Oh,
so I'm pleased I did go out the game. Like I say, I hit 70 fights, lost 13, and could have been a contender as this year.
Well,
yeah.
Is that when you took on Art?
I got diagnosed with bipolar 5 years ago.
Right.
6 years ago, the mental nurse says, do what? And I said, I can't appear, I can't draw. But I had a chemical imbalance of the brain. I lost a year of life.
Right.
And then mental institutions and that. And luckily, my wife and family support us. And now I've just been, I've done my degree at university. I've got a first with honours. I've done it on our armed services, past and present.
Uh-huh.
And got a first with honours, I'm doing my masters now. And the other year I got out of bed and I read about that Tommy. And my dad was called Tommy.
Uh-huh.
And he'd be the same type of guy, do things for charity and I help people out.
Yeah.
And I thought, yeah, let's get in the art studio, we have a bill for us. And I just sat down and I just started painting, and by the end of the day I took it in, I said, what do you think of that? She said, it's fantastic. And I just put it on and it had just a thing, and the next day I put it on, and I said, and all of a sudden the pinging noise started on my phone.
Uh-huh.
And I got a bit nervous. So what I'd done, I phoned up a guy called Steve Aliff. And he lives down Leicester. I met him on holiday a few years ago. And he fought Bartley Gorman. Have you heard of Bartley Gorman?
Yeah, of course.
He won one of the men to beat Bartley Gorman in the bare knuckle fight. And for some reason, I phoned them up, and we discussed things, and my phone's ringing, my brother, Sean's ringing us, different ones ringing us, me, oh, Katie, oh, Andrea, and my wife's ringing us. And I thought, oh, what's going on here? And then all of a sudden, when my wife came in June, she went, Andy, it's getting pretty viral, like, you know?
Yeah.
So since then, mate, all I'm doing now is sitting here, painting, loads of painting.
Yeah.
We've gone for charity, and I'd like to thank Phil for getting in touch with you, just to give us a chance to express what's where my life's went a bit, you know. And,
no, that's fine.
Just to chat with ideas, you know. This could be the start of it. But I look at it, not in life, when you get knocked down, you've got to pick yourself up and didn't cry all the time, get on with someone else. But one thing I look at, you know Gandhi?
Yes.
Charlie respects him, big style, Charlie Bronson.
Okay.
Charles Salvador, as he likes to be called. He says, Andy, that's a powerful man. He says that what he's saying was, first they laugh at you, then they hate you, then they fight you, and then you win. It's something similar to that. That's one of his sayings.
Right.
And I think with his bipolar, and for years, for 6 years, for the first years, I was tapping pictures of people in the street, and I still do now.
Yeah.
I take pictures of different people and I paint them, and you know, but they are, and I imagine a lot of people over the years have looked and laughed at and thought, I've lost the plot. But now the good thing about it, I was tapping tablets because I haven't lost the plot. But in this world, in this funny old world that we live in now, it was right and it was wrong, you know?
Yeah. But, so you've started like a new chapter then? You've started a new chapter in your life then?
Oh, honestly, I'm loving it. I think this could be. I always say, like, we'll get there in the end. Like I say, I've got 5 grandkids, 3 daughters, 1 great-grandson. And, you know, by the ups and downs over the years, different things have happened, bad things have happened. Mm-hmm. And you've just got to dust yourself down. You know, I do a few paints for the Sayers family from Newcastle. I respect them lads. They've been brought up the hard way, and they've got a book I've tried and tested.
Right.
Oh, yeah, them are good lads. I do a paint for them, and I think it's focused into the bare-knuckle world. I do a paint for them and different ones.
Yeah.
Country. I mean, the present governor now, they call him Gary Furby. Okay. He's from North Shields.
Right.
I think he is. And he's a top of kid. He's 40-year-old, and he fought on the Charlie Bronson to get Charlie, raise money for Charlie Bronson when he was years and years ago, down London.
Okay.
And he won the title, the Governor Belt, and he's just won it again, he has. And he's in with, have you heard of Storm and Norman Buckland?
No, I haven't.
He's one of the original governors. If you have a look on there, the internet, you'll see that fight.
Uh-huh.
And I was also in the Lenny McLean film. My name's Lenny.
Right, okay.
I got a partner now, Jamie. I've done a couple of paintings for Jamie. And that's where it was different routes in life, you know.
Yeah.
I gone down the blind beggar. There's a guy called Mickey Goldtooth.
Uh-huh.
He's got the naughty bus and the teach on all the tours around London where all the gangsters and celebrities did and all that, you know.
Yeah.
So it's taken us different places, and I'm looking, I'm thinking, you know. And now all of a sudden with his Tommy, and they had dedicated my father and my uncle Bobby.
Yeah.
He was in the forces, and he got murdered in 1966, he did. Oh, yeah. He come up the forces, and his father-in-law, a man called Norman Brunton, you can see it on the, you can put it in, Norman Brunton murderer, it tells you about how he murdered his son-in-law, that's my uncle Bobby. Like, my name's Andrew Robert, I'm named after my uncle Bobby.
Mm.
And he murdered him on a Christmas morning in 1966.
Bloody hell, man.
It even tells you about what happened with it, and you know, now he charged, and it's a crooked game, so life hasn't been so smooth for those Parkins. Like, say, 6 brothers,
yeah.
6 brothers, 2 sisters, 5 of us, well fought, you know, and it's old Trevor, old Matty, old Tom,
yeah.
Old Trevor, old Sean, and the sisters, Abel and Catherine, you know.
So what about Captain Tom Moore? He's 99 years old and he vowed to keep on walking, but now he's hit the 17 million target, hasn't he?
Oh, to be honest with you, that inspired me so much, and I'm like humbled by this happening to me, by me getting recognition. So I feel as if he's like not just raised our awareness for everything, he's he's given me the chance to maybe talk about bipolar mental health.
Yeah.
And now to say to people, didn't give up.
Yeah.
Like Charlie says, and this is me, Bull. He always says, Andy, what we are is born again artists.
Right.
You know? And that's what we are. And the DNL put on Free the Artists Within. And with Tommy, he's just got that spirit of the fighting spirit and Dunkirk, you know? Just it gives. And at this time, I think it gives the whole country a feel-good factor.
A bit of a lift, yeah.
Times, you know.
That's right. So what about?
I think.
As I say, so how are you gonna sell it? Because you don't often sell all your art, do you? But
no. Honestly, mate, you know what it is. I put it like I served my time as a bricklayer, and I never started making money until I worked for 6 years. I think you serve your apprenticeship, then you start getting better and better. Well, now I said at the beginning of this year, it's my 6th year. Being an artist from scratch, not having to pick the pencil up yet. I'm at the standard now. I can sell, and I will sell, and I'm a true believer. if you want to go for something, go for it and big day it.
Yeah.
So they say the patents, my daughter, Alandria and Katie and Abby, the daughters working around it together on eBay, and it's up for sale now. There's really just been just from London offered £500. I have to tell my daughter, offered £500 for it, and hopefully, mate, I've got to tell you the truth, mate, if you can get in touch with Tyson Fury, I've got a big picture now of him. And I've got that big bit now, it's about 4 foot at the top of 10 of them. I think then to him, tell him if he wants to buy that.
Okay.
The money that was different charities, you know.
Yeah.
I painted one of, Robbie Williams and Tony Jeffrey, Jaffa's son, because he trains Robbie Williams.
Yeah.
And I've done a painting of that. It's unbelievable, it's a big one.
Yeah.
And I painted it like the Tyson Fury there in the background, an ET. And they're getting out of Robbie Williams's plane, and there's a spaceship there. Because I found out that Robbie Williams spent millions of pounds to find out if there is extraterrestrials.
Oh, okay.
So I painted Tyson Fury next to it, and to me, like the story of it that goes with it is the week before. When Tyson Fury was fighting in America, Robbie Williams and Tony Jeffries were out in his dressing room, and they said, look, and Robbie Williams said to Tyson, they tell me he'd sing a bit. And he went, oh, nice, well, I want you on my next album.
Mm.
True to his word, Robbie Williams got Tyson Fury on his album.
Yeah.
So I had E.T. with a microphone in his mouth, and Tyson Fury with a microphone in his mouth, and the wire going through Tony Jeffries, and threw Robbie Williams into a spaceship, you know?
And
that's the narrative of the story, you know? It's unbelievable.
Well,
if
I'm
Robbie
speaking...
Robbie Williams wants to buy that, so much of that to charity, you know?
Yeah, well, I'm speaking to Tony on Monday.
Phil got an article printed in the Sun and Echo. And to be honest, I couldn't believe it. Straight away, he's on the phone to the lady, Katie, from the Sun and Echo. Phoned up, and they've got to put in the same deal. And the picture that they put inside was of me, Stan with Tony, with the painting where Tony signed it.
Oh, okay.
You know, and he signed some prints for a lovely lad, Tony. Tell you a story about that lad. My dad was 8 years old, and he had cancer. And I phoned Tony up, and to tell you the truth, after I had a heart attack when I was 42. So I had a pack in Britain, and I become a debt collector. So I bought myself a Reliant Robin car.
Okay.
I had a spray jeller, and I put on the side to go to like the Worden Parkin's Independent Deck Clipping. From Seaburn to New York on the back. And I put, one of my sins was the mount me out to get to his mum, you know? And I phoned Tony up, and lo and behold, within an hour, he come up with my dad in his brand new, in his car, and pulled up for his gold medal, and I've got the pictures there now where I'm standing with my brothers and giving me dad holding the medal, and it was just a tremendous thing for him to do.
Yeah.
So I walked in with my grandson, now with John, eldest grandson, and I said, who's here, Dad? He said, hi, son, how are John? Good lad. and Tony Jeffries walked in, my dad, do you, mate? That's what I'd done when Tony was fighting in the Commonwealth Games. I sponsored him, like from my dad, for £50, and Tony done a lovely letter for him, and I've got a friend in house still, and I got my picture took with Tony and the lads and Jaffa, you know?
Yeah.
So he's done a lot for us, and Tony, and
nice lad.
He's a top kid, honestly, hell of a kid, and that's lovely to see people do well. There's a lot of people don't like it, but to me, he's up there, he's working every day, and you know, when he coming home that day, I met him at the... Where was it? The fans' place at Roca. Monk Weymouth, where they've got the museum.
Okay.
Where some supporters are. And he signed about 20 prints of us, you know. So, but there you go, with that painting, if Robbie Williams wants to buy it, so much will go to charity and so much will go to grandkids.
Yeah, exactly. Have a word with Phil to speak with Tony. To get in contact
If you don't mind me, tell him it's Tony saying the standard of it. If he sends an email, I'll give him my email address and I'll email it to you, the picture, and if you can tell me that I've got the Tyson Fury one, Me and I met Tyson Fury a few months ago when he was doing a talking down Middlesbrough way.
Right.
And I took a painting down for him. And I asked the security, can I give the terrible security get stripped. His dad was on the stage. And then at the end, I got in and I said, Tyson. He went, what? I said, the painting. I want the painting. So he's got one of my paintings as well.
Oh, nice.
But I've got thousands of paintings, tell you the truth. It's my therapy. It helps us through the day.
Well, maybe once everything's all sorted out there, Andy, once everything's sorted out, maybe open up a weekend gallery or something, and
I've got my art studio here. That's going to be the plans for the future. Yeah. To put a board outside. I'm like old school, I am. And put a board up to coming in, have a look. Yeah. And with this Tom thing, it's given me a feeling of like humbling feeling, but of like euphoria, like that. Is it happening? The day that changed, it's like with this virus, it changed the world. Yeah. But with this painting gone viral, I'm thinking, God, you know, it couldn't be so nice. You know, to feel so.
Andy.
The daughters are all buzzing. And the grandkids are all granddad this and that. And as they were feliciting the little granddaughter I've got, she's 4 year old. I keep on saying to her, "You're going to be famous, you." And she went, "Grandad, stop winding this up, will you?" So now the daughter went, "I can't wait." She wants to sing and say, "Grandad, you're famous."
Yeah.
And there's the two grandsons, old Farron and Leon. Then I put a punch bag up for them, so them are training in isolation, a telling farm. I tell Abby's boys.
Yeah.
And what the company should do, I think, give these kids a round of applause. Because I don't know if you think about it, there's you never hear about much knife crime now.
No.
And has it been a wake up call for the world, I think?
Well,
More people are talking in the streets when you want them, even though you keep them 2 meters apart. Uh-huh. You know, I've even got the one brew ready, so I put a little office stone on. the casserole dish is gonna probably sell out the window.
Right. Yeah, that's it. I'll tell you what, Andy. So, if you can give me the link to that picture of Tom Moore, he's on the eBay, is that right?
Yes, it'll be on eBay.
Okay, so if you can send me a link to it, and I'll put it.
Can I tell you my email address?
You tell me once.
I'll send it on your phone.
Yeah, do that. So I'll put a link to it in the description box of this video. I will. Yes. So if people want to go in there and have a bid, then they can. All right.
That's custom, mate. Thank you so much for your time.
I appreciate it, Andy.
And if I can paid for you something handmade, just give a shout.
Good plan, that.
Just ask Eddie Earn. Tell me who's me and Charlie Salvador. £600.
Will do.
Turn on, mate.
All right, buddy. You take care. No worries.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.